distracted by what's in front of them, and the busier they are, the harder it is to do this. So someone has to keep the big picture in mind. And this is basically the list of what that is. Monitoring everything, watching some schedule, working backwards from some due date to see if you have any chance of hitting it, and if not, what you're going to cut, reminding of your priorities, et cetera, et cetera. And that last bullet's pretty important as well. Keeping an eye on people's morale. The busier you are, the harder it is to do this. Little known fact, games are supposed to be fun, right? So, like just feeding people, like how often people will eat and not drink, they'll just get distracted, they'll have their headphones on and they're working. They'll get dehydrated, they'll get tired, they'll make stupider decisions. Have that stuff every time you're working. Someone brings some snacks and drinks, right? Seating matters. This one's actually aimed more at like the game jam type stuff, if you got the 48-hour stuff. If you're all using Unreal and one person uses it a lot more than everyone else, have them in some central location so everyone can ask them questions. It may not apply to how you guys do it, I'm not sure. Have some way to keep ongoing notes that are easy to manage and to keep with you throughout the whole process. You're often going to say something, forget the specifics of what it was, and you don't want to have to take that time to redo it, so have some way of tracking your notes. Rapid iteration, like I said, that is the magic of games, that is the magic of polish, being able to play it early and get feedback and do it over and over and over again. Whatever you can do to make that happen. Tuning hooks is just one example of, I know that if I'm making a platformer, I'm going to have to do jump arc, jump speed, button feedback, landing animations, etc. Can we make that so that one person can just take a sheet of numbers and tune everything by hand rather than having to go to an engineer and animator every time we want to change something? Plan that early. This is one that people underappreciate as well. So it's not just a matter of picking an environment and software you're familiar with. Sometimes it's about people trying to make a game that runs on iOS and Android and PC and console. Usually the student projects don't do that, but you'd be surprised somehow. And that's not really the point, I think, of most of these programs. That's not really what we're looking for people starting out in the field either. That's more of a shipping game running company issue. But more often, it's a matter of people not having all their software working. Hey, does everyone have Perforce? Yeah, it turns out you've got incompatible versions of Perforce, or pick whatever, or Unity, and someone patched and someone doesn't, and you can't read their files, et cetera, et cetera. So you don't want to spend your first few days or weeks trying to figure out software license and who has what. It's almost like just pick something and build what you can with that thing and have somebody like that producer person make sure that everyone's got the right stuff before you start the creative process. You see, this is boring but important, right? As an example for hackathons, this is the two-day thing, and I'm using this because this is what I'm most familiar with as it applies to student projects. I think our two-day and one-week projects are closer to what you guys do than our big team projects that happen over time. So everyone gets to know each other, you talk about what different things mean, you brainstorm and you try to have your first playable on the first day with the basic actions. And a big part of that is the trying to figure out what you're going to do and what not to is risk. Sometimes risk is the thing that you want to tackle first. And when you do tackle things that are risky, like something you've never done or sort of some core concept that's difficult to do, you should have a fallback plan. And this is something people are usually caught flat-footed. If the real thing they wanted to do didn't work, it's better to have something than nothing. So what's your fallback plan? And sometimes the gist of the idea is good enough. Do you guys all know this website, Low Cost Cosplay? You know, you can give the impression of something without actually having to finish it, right? So this is an Overwatch joke. This guy is brilliant, so please check out his gallery if you haven't seen him before. So many characters he covers here. But like the Ghost Pirate ship from earlier, just giving the impression of some stuff. Start to fill in the edges with the more gray, blurry stuff so you can focus on what matters and what's right in front of people. And then just cut. The sunk cost fallacy, does everyone know what that means? It simply means that, well, we spent so much time on this, we have to finish it. That ruins a lot of projects in and of itself, regardless of all the other things I've said. People chasing a bad idea for too long. Sometimes a bad idea, it's just not its time. It'll be a good idea in the future, and you just don't have time now. You've got to really keep your eye on the schedule. Like I said, we shut down the auction house. No matter how much development time we did it, it just wasn't right for the game. It actually took longer to shut it down and unentwine it from the game and all of the regional markets than it did to make it in the first place, and we still did it. So I mentioned milestones and working backwards from your end date. That's a great way to schedule. We have to submit our final project here, so what should it look like about a week before that? Well, it should be mostly done, and we should only be doing bugs, right, and keep working backwards from where you are now, and then keep those milestones. And when you can, start cutting so that you can meet those milestones, so the fewer, better things as possible. If my fabled platformer I keep mentioning was the thing, if only jumping was fun and there was no enemies or anything else, but the jumping felt pretty good, that's better than having lame jumping and lame enemies. All right, so we're running a little short in time, so I think you guys will be able to have a copy of this. I'll move through the summary slides a little faster. Don't undervalue logistics and plan that stuff in advance and try to get it out of the way and have a producer monitor it, or that will ruin your fun. Okay. So iteration, I keep talking about this. How does it actually work? We've seen that already. So feedback. Getting feedback and giving feedback is difficult, harder than it seems. People put a lot of emotion into these things. Your ideas, you can have a ton of passion, and if somebody's trashing it or they use words that are not the best words to say what they don't like about it, like this sucks, for example, that can hurt your feelings, which means you're not able to listen to their feedback well. So developing a thick skin is part of it, but also be the feedback giver that you want to have, right? Like the way that you, I think that's the next slide, is how to give feedback as well, but this is a stereotype, but very true. You learn more from your mistakes than your successes, for sure. Successes are almost, like I said, when something works well the first time, it almost never happens again, which means you can't learn a lot from it. Trying something and failing and trying again and succeeding, that's the way you learn, and that's the way lessons stick. So whatever you've screwed up in any of these things, your next project's going to be that much better because of it. So make it okay when things don't go well. So root cause. People will try to help you when they give feedback, and what that means is usually they'll try to jump and give you solutions, and you may not spend enough time talking about what the problem is that caused them to give this feedback in the first place. So if you're making a shooter game and somebody said you needed to add more guns to your game, maybe that's true, or maybe the guns you have aren't great. Like, you have to figure out what caused them to say this feedback, and they're trying to be helpful. Oh, you need more guns. What they mean is that your core gun it's not shooting well, or it's got bad feedback, or it looks awful, or something. So how to give feedback. The opposite of that is always talk about the idea, not the person, and talk about how to improve the idea. Like, I see what you're going for. What if you tried this or this or this? Like, assume the idea is good, and they just haven't quite figured out how to deliver it properly, as opposed to assuming the idea is bad. So try to be helpful and be someone that they look forward to giving feedback from, as opposed to someone they dread. And even if you're giving really hard feedback, like, I don't think you should have this feature, there's nicer and not nicer ways to see it. Okay, this is another stereotype that is true. Perfect is the enemy of good. So please read this Brad Bird quote, please. You don't have to have everything perfect. And I keep floating around this idea in a variety of ways, whether it's the low-cost cosplay or that ghost ship example of a lot of things in the game can just be references as opposed to polish. It's all about picking the fewest, best things that you're actually making and not getting distracted by stuff like title screen, great, it's nice, that's the first thing people see, it's important, but is it as important as the gameplay? Can people spend more time making an awesome animation on a title screen and less time on the animation of the actual character they're playing? Absolutely they can, and I've seen it. Edge cases, since you're not shipping this game, are usually not something you have to worry about as well. So sometimes just moving a problem to the side or keeping it out of the core gameplay or away from the player or later in the experience is better than actually trying to fix it so that you can spend more time making your awesome, awesome. Here is a Blizzard design value called make it overpowered. And this simply refers to go way past the line, whatever the line is, cross it as far as possible, and then start pulling it back to be something realistic. Fun or awesome or great things, it's easier to take out the things that aren't working than it is to try to make something creep towards the line, worrying about crossing it. We go way too far and make things way too expensive, way too many effects on the screen. We always do that, and I think it ends up having a greater overall experience in the end because everything ends up being somewhat epic, and more often than not, it's what the hardware can handle that constrains us and than anything else, and that's a good place to be. Make it a bonus is another Blizzard design value that I think applies to all sorts of things. Anyone that's played Diablo will recognize the treasure chest thing here. I wish we had the sound as well. There's like this iconic sound that's been around in one version or another ever since Diablo 1, and we call this the loot fountain. It's not just that you open a chest and you get an item from it, it always explodes out of it. Everything in Diablo explodes, but loot itself, gold, always blows up as well. There's no reason for it other than to give people this visceral response every time they open a treasure chest or kill a monster. And And that's a version of make it a bonus. So the other ways we apply that, if you're making a platformer and you want someone not to go somewhere, one way to do that is there's a spike-filled pit, and if they try to go there, they'll die. The other way to do that is there's a treasure chest in the direction that you want them to go. This is probably more than we have time to handle, but our loot system, in short, loot-based games, people will go where the loot is even if they're not having fun. They cannot help themselves. We struggled with that a lot. We tried to shut down all the ways that people could get loot, so they only did the things that were fun. We ended up giving awesome loot out and tons of it in the areas we felt where the game was best, and that ended up having the game feel way better as opposed to shutting down the things that were convenient, having them go back to the stuff that they were not getting loot from. All right. Again, we'll zoom through the summary slide. You can read it later, but there's some important elements in there. And these are some Blizzard design values that I think apply to most games, no matter what you're making. All right, coming to the end. So no matter what, you have to celebrate. It's important. Like, even if you failed at the goals that you set out for, I don't know if you get a bad grade or what failure looks like in any of these classes or projects or hackathons or game jams or whatever you call them, remember that you learn more from your failure than your successes. So, in fact, the people that failed have the most lessons to apply to the next project versus somebody for whom it went swimmingly. I'm not joking when I say that. So, celebrate. These things are hard. Making games is not easy. It's not easy at all. Don't do networking. I know you guys are going to do that. At least half of you have networking, don't you? Don't forget the fallback plan. So whatever your favorite feature is, always have a plan B and maybe even a plan C. Even if it's kind of lame, it's better to have something than nothing. It's better to have a game that isn't what you want it to be, but at least runs, than an idea that you tried and didn't have time to finish. All right, so wrapping up before questions, I do want to say that as hard as making games is, and how I also say it's supposed to be fun and those things are kind of at odds, I think that we're lucky to be here where we are. Simply because we have not reached that point where games making is a known science, and I'm not entirely convinced that it ever will be. For film students or people interested in movies, there's reference to what people call the Citizen Kane moment, and it's just that this movie pioneered a lot of effects and did some things that had never been done before that are still widely used today. So that was like they brought together a whole bunch of the art and they put it in a presentation that filmmakers of the future continue to use to this day. I don't think games are going to have that. I don't think that we have a simple enough medium. We have too many mediums and too many platforms and too many types of things that can happen in games. I'm not even sure we're going to have that by genre. I think the role-playing game genre is very, very wide. So even if somebody learns exactly how to make a Dungeons & Dragons game, that may not apply to many other things. So we're always going to be explorers out there in space here. We're never going to have all the answers. And that can be frightening or that can be exciting. And it's probably a little mixture of both. When I say we're privileged, it's like we're doing things, whatever we're doing now is going to look very different 10 years from now. I can't imagine what games are going to look like 20 years from now. Is it going to be augmented reality or virtual reality merged into the things we do now? Are we going to gamify the world? Something else I haven't even thought of? Will we have controllers? Will be everything done with our brains? Like, we don't know. We're building the future, and it's pretty exciting, right? So, be bold. Try new things. You're going to have to anyway, so you might as well sometimes shoot for the stars and sometimes ignore my advice and bat for the outfield, whatever you want to call it. It's stressful, and you're tired, and you're hungry and thirsty because you didn't pick a producer to bring snacks and things like that. Don't attack each other. We're all in this together. Don't be snide about other games, even if it's a game you don't like. Once you've done this for a while, you're going to respect every effort, even the ones that fail. There's no bad games out there. There's just some unlucky circumstances where people's dream was not able to become a reality. Even if you run across a game developer who's super arrogant about it, that's probably some sort of defensiveness rooted in their childhood and nothing to do with them actually thinking that their crappy product is good. We're usually pretty hard on each other, and we're usually pretty hard on ourselves despite how we might present to the outside world. So, you know, be kind. Get enough rest, which is advice we don't always follow ourselves, but it's something we should all be saying to each other. And try to make the game, you know, better than the sum of its parts. All the advice I have in this talk is about trying to get the fewest things working the best together as you can. So, you know, we all gather these references from all over the place and these archetypes and elements from our favorite games and try to turn it into something new. things we have to try to turn into something new, the better it's going to be. And that follows, like, the keep it simple. It's really easy to get distracted. I wanted to do this, and along the way, all the tangents happened, and I ended up doing this, right? I'm sure you guys even now have experienced, I started doing this one thing, and then 25 roads down later, and side paths, and so forth, this thing I thought was going to be the easy part, I'm not even finished yet. That is normal, and it also happens in the professional world, so cutting, working within milestones is the kind of only way to control it, and at that, barely. And this is my final. All right, thank you. How much time do we have for questions, if any? Okay, so I can hang out for a little while afterwards. I don't know if there's another class in here, but let's go with what time we have, and if anyone wants to talk to me afterwards. I do have some sub-awesome swag, which are multicolored Blizzard stickers here. Please, everyone, grab one. And focus on the positive of this, of how light it was for me to carry this here today in my bag. So, questions, comments? Yeah, well, you and then you. Yep.
So, I won't do it for a student project, but if you have any suggestions for how to learn to code a multiplayer game with networking, where would you go? You just have to hire someone who's already done it? That's kind of a catch-22.
No, it's more that it depends on the length of your game. If you have 2 or 3 years to make a game, and you're doing it throughout your whole game development career, or you're doing your master's or something, you probably can do networking. Then that's more of that risk analysis thing. Okay, networking is going to be risky if you listen to me, and I may be wrong. So let's get that part working early. But if you have like a 1 quarter project or something, I'm suggesting you maybe just avoid that. Or learn a separate networking coding class before you try to apply it to games or whatever. I think it is getting better, and I do look forward to the day where I remove that advice altogether. Like Unity, I think, has got a better networking solution than the other, where things just connect and you don't have to worry about it. There was a time when graphics didn't work, things like that in game development as well, and the amount of driver manipulation you had to do was crazy. We're mostly past that stage, or the driver companies or the graphics programmers are getting way better at it, whatever. So I hope we'll get there.
So I feel like games are kind of almost like a subset of, you know, real-time 3D experiences, but you feel like, I don't know, sometimes, like, I think the way games started are basically, like, you have a goal, like, you're trying to rescue the princess or something, and, like, I guess that's where this term game came from, but do you feel like the art form could benefit from, I don't know, like looking at other, I feel like games are like very goal-oriented. Like, can you talk a little bit about how that maybe makes them like different from other art forms?
Yeah, the genre lines, and I don't mean game genres in this case, just like games versus movies. Let's just talk entertainment forms. They're getting more and more blurred all the time, I think. Like virtual reality is still, it's been tried a couple times before, it sort of faded into the background. This time it seems to be sticking for a while. And I think that we're very much barely learning how to use it properly. Like, there's one thing of taking a game that plays normally and then doing a version where you can also play it in VR versus games that are built for that medium from scratch. For a long, long time, games have felt like the poor younger sibling of movies. And, you know, animators in games are people who couldn't make it in movies back in the 90s or something like that. I think that cachet has changed. Have a lot to learn from other genres. The thing is, I think that's what we've been doing all along. It's more that games need to find their own feet and embrace, like I was saying in the Citizen Kane slide there, who knows where we're going to go. We're going to be leading the future of entertainment more than any other type I can think of, more than novels or poetry or 2D art or movies. We're going to be doing the things that are way more interactive. When you say goal-oriented, I think that's generally true, but not completely true, and there are exceptions to that. Or there's games that handle goals completely different. Like Journey's still a goal-oriented game if you think about it, but the way that it gets you there, completely different than something like Diablo, which is leading you around by the ring through your nose with constant treasure, right? Totally different experiences, though they're kind of the same. So how you do it is maybe a bigger deal than it should be doing something else. The serious games movement of games that teach about depression or child abuse or things like that, those games aren't even meant to be fun, right? Blizzard games are all about fun. we're not doing that side of it, but that side is growing every year. So there's like a whole new subgenre or angle on our art that's barely starting as well. What's that going to be like in 20 years? Is most of what kids learn in elementary and middle school going to be done in a gamified manner? Probably, maybe. Yes.
Did you have any work on the World of Warcraft film that came out a couple years ago?
No. Our creative director was involved in the background story, but I think it was pretty much entirely done by Duncan Jones and his team.
Oh,
so sorry.
That's okay.
Nothing. I said the internship program is getting better every year. Come in with any experience you have whatsoever. We have more positions open, which means we'll widen the net. We do get a lot of applications, and most people, definitely it's a bigger number that don't get picked than get picked. But yeah, don't be scared to apply. And if you're lucky, you'll get a little bit of feedback from one of our recruiters telling you what you should do next year differently. We definitely have cases where interns come 3 years in a row, and in many of those cases, they end up getting hired. So yeah, apply for as many things as you can. If it's a complete reach, like you know nothing about coding and you want to apply for one of the programming internships, that probably won't work out. Design, for example, is way more vague, and there's just not that many degrees out there, so we kind of don't look at the degree program so much as the quality of their application itself, knowing that the whole game design field, like I said in my slideshow, is barely developed, so therefore difficult to teach the science of at this point. Yes? I've been in World of Warcraft for 2 years, so I mostly play World of Warcraft because you have to.
Yeah,
to have any, you can't be a lead designer in this game. I play at least 15 hours a week of World of Warcraft. In an ideal circumstances, I would probably play 3 or 4 hours of that and a bunch of things in other games. But to be honest, since I've gone there, I've had trouble playing games, even ones I'm super passionate about. So about 15 hours a week. I play more on my phone because I can do it when I'm not at work easier, even when I'm at home. Something I need to test in the real world. Here, here, and then there.
So, World of Warcraft, as a game that's existed for 15 years or so, it seems like it'd be a very different design experience than just creating a new game from scratch. Like,
yep.
What are some of the most different things? How do you work with that much of a legacy?
It's very much an anchor on your neck if you let it be. In the simple version is you always want to keep it fresh without losing the players that are there for a reason. WoW is WoW, and it's to your own detriment to make it not feel like World of Warcraft. But what it is today versus what it was 15 years ago are very, very different. It's just a matter of how fast that change goes. So in many cases, we'll have fairly bold ideas that we try to WoWify so it's not too different of an experience for the players. In many cases, we'll experiment with something in a patch and then release the full version of it in the next expansion or maybe even two expansions down the road, like the full game releases. And that's a good way to get people used to an idea without making them change all their gameplay. They can try it before they buy it, basically. Here and then there and then there. I think are pretty much.
I think this will be our last question, actually.
Okay.
If you have other questions, you can stay after.
Oh, thank you. So how come the Blizzard idea of rapid iteration doesn't translate into balance patches with games, especially like Hearthstone or, and to a lesser degree, Overwatch? Like Blizzard seems reluctant to nerf or buff things relative to like similar games from other developers.
I don't think we actually have time to answer that question. What's the shortest possible version I can do of that? We're reluctant to nerf and buff anything because the circumstances under which you use it, sometimes power can be powerful in some circumstances and not in others. And if you only come at it from the experience, I experienced this and it wasn't strong enough, especially Hearthstone cards, in other circumstances with other things, it is strong enough. So buffing it here might make it overpowered, and likewise, nerfing it might ruin it completely. So we've got to do that slowly. Suffice to say, there is actually a lot of iteration internally. We just have to be super careful with the balance that actually meets the audience. We'll do older things in PTRs or internally than we'll actually let out. We've got to move it slowly. It's like running an economy. You can't just go crazy with your money policy in a modern economy. You can't experiment too much. You've got to slowly move it forward, like when the Fed changes interest rates. As slow and as infrequently as possible,